I've waited over 22 years just to tell this story. Perhaps I've waited all my life. It's about a father, a son, and a long-lost 55 Chevy. This was my father's dream car, built just like the one he and my mother dated in long before I was born. The one my father was a local racing legend with, and the one the law constantly chased. That 55 met its demise with a speed bump and a light pole on its way to Myrtle Beach in 1969. The 55 he built in 1991 and 1992 won countless trophies and shows in Tennessee, South Carolina, and North Carolina. The memories my mother and father made in this 55 are priceless. The memories my family made in this 55 are priceless. You see, this 55 just isn't a car. It's part of my family. My daddy was forced to sell his dream car in 2001 when my beautiful, loving mother was diagnosed with cancer. My mother fought that disease fiercely until God called her home on January 28th, 2005. On my father's birthday. On my father's birthday. Soon after, I made a promise to myself that someday, someway, I'd find my daddy's 55. I'd buy it and I'd bring it back home for him to enjoy. Little did I know, it would take me over 17 years just to find it. This is that story. I am my father's son.
I am my father's son.
This is a story like you've probably never heard. It is kind of unbelievable, even for me. And to sit here right now and to tell you this story is very surreal. And to have this car sitting here beside me is a dream come true that is a lifetime in the making. When I was a little kid, when I was old enough to really realize what cars were, my mom and dad had this photo album, and in that photo album, they had pictures of his old cars, from 67 Chevelles to Volkswagens, but mainly 55 Chevrolets. And I loved those cars. And amongst those pictures were a green 55 Chevrolet in particular that my dad had before I was born, and really made a name for himself in our area, local here in Lenoir, North Carolina, Caldwell County. He raced it a lot, got in trouble with it a lot, ran open headers, the place they cruised around, the big Rebel. Law kind of chased him quite a bit, stayed on him, knew who he was, and he was very well known for that car. And I have so many people over the years tell me so many different stories of my dad in that car. For example, just last year, Eddie Land's father, he since passed away, told a story that I'd never heard. And it's those stories that have driven me for years to not give up on this dream. So Eddie's dad told me that years ago, he seen the green 55 coming up 321 towards Happy Valley, and it was a two-lane then. And my dad passed him running over 100 mile an hour. He was sure it was running over 100 mile an hour. And it wasn't but a few seconds later, he looked in the rearview mirror and he could see blue lights coming. So he made his car, which happened to be a 55, he made it pretty wide and got in the middle of the road as he was driving. And he kind of took up both lanes to where the lawman could not get by him to catch up with my dad. And that was sometime in the 60s. And all these years, he thought my dad actually got away, because the guy, that trooper never caught up with my dad. So when my dad heard this story last year, he made the comment that he didn't get away, that they radioed ahead and another trooper was waiting for him close to where my grandmother's driveway up her holler was, up to Hull Holler on 268 down in Happy Valley. So that's just a small part of the stories and the legend that my dad was before I was born. It's what I heard since I was a kid growing up, and it just instilled in me that I wanted to be like my dad. And I was a normal kid. I loved cars. I loved Dukes of Hazzard, Smokey and the Bandit, stock car racing. My dad watched it every Sunday, took us every time the gates opened at North Wilkesboro Speedway twice a year. Charlotte, I've been to Rockingham, just so many races that I went to because of my dad, and would sit on Sundays and watch racing with my dad. So racing, NASCAR, 55 Chevrolets, and old hot rods was in my blood from an early age. And going back to this photo album, there was that green 55 Chevrolet, and I never could quit staring at it. I would sit in school in class in fifth and sixth grade and get in trouble for drawing 55 Chevrolets and drawing that car. That's how much I wanted that car. And over the years, my dad had several 55s, but never one quite like that 55. It was a legend in its own time, super fast. Its demise came on a trip to Myrtle Beach with him and three of his buddies. Had a little too much to drink, got in some kind of street race around Charlotte, hit a speed bump, and then introduced that 55 to a light pole, and it did not end well. Killed the car. Luckily, they walked away with some broke bones, bruises, glass in their feet, and very lucky to walk away. The Lord was with them. So I've heard that story all my life. That car ended up getting buried near where my grandmother's house was, right along the Yadkin River. And I think it was buried to help build up the bank of the Yadkin River. And that color was Grecian green. It was always specific to my dad. That was his favorite color. There was no other green like it. I can remember people asking my dad what color that actually was, and he would tell them a little fib, wouldn't tell them the truth, because he didn't want nobody else to paint their car Grecian green. And I've always got a joy and a kick out of knowing that, and knowing that's how particular my dad is. And he's super particular with cars, if you know my dad, and many of you do. So fast forward, as I grew up, Dad had several 55s, but none like the green one. Somewhere along 1988, he gave me a 70 Chevelle, gold, black stripes, black vinyl top. When I turned 16, it was a surprise. He kept it hid from me, and it was restored, painted. I had it sitting in a carport and brought me outside to see it. I didn't even know it was there. And beautiful. I was astonished. It was one of my favorite cars, and the car that I wanted at that time. And he opened the door and said, get in it. And I got in it and cranked it up. An old cassette player was playing Conway Twitty. And he purposely had Conway Twitty's song, That's My Job, playing. And if you know that song, that's about a little boy starts off in a song scared. He's had a bad dream and scared that his dad passed away. And he runs to his dad in the middle of the night. And his dad, you know, takes him up and tells him it's going to be all right. And the story continues as the son grows up and moves away to follow his own path, and ends up being back home later in life. And his dad eventually passes away, but he's there for his dad in the end, like his dad was there for him in the beginning. That's never left me. When my oldest son turned 16, I played the same song in a blazer that I gave him for his 16th birthday. Keep that in mind. I'll get back to that. We'll come back to that and make it full circle here in a minute, and you'll realize why that is so special to me. So about a year after I got the Chevelle, my dad bought another 55, a black one, and a hard top, local car, super good car, and he was going to restore it just like the green one that I had heard about all my life. And I was beside myself. My mom and him dated in that car in the 60s. So much history with that car. His friends, family, everybody knew him in that car. They were one. His best friend, Gary Martin, was, I think, very instrumental in my dad's love for 55s. They both had so many 55s over the years that it's burnt in my memory and in my mind that, you know, that's the car. Those are the cars. And it's an honor. Well, it's more or less they were my heroes, and it was an honor to grow up watching them in these old cars and their old 55s. And the older I've got, the more I have stuck with nostalgia and clinging to things that bring back memories, whether it be my grandfather's pipe or my doorknobs off my great-grandmother's house or great-grandfather's house. I'm just that way. That's how I'm made. So, second part of this story gets into my dad having this car and wanting to restore it and make it just like the green one he had in the 60s. And I got to help him tear the car apart. Got to help him turn bolts on it. Dennis Wolf painted it, one of the renowned restorers and painters in our area. He's since retired. And he painted it, restored it, frame off on a rotisserie. I got taught how to buff on the trunk of this 55 sitting here beside me. So my bond with my dad grows even more with this car when it came along. And I got to experience building a car with him and learning how to build a car, learning how to take care of one, learning how to keep one clean, learning the value of all that. And you can't put words really to describe it, you can't put a price on it. And that's how I was raised, and I'm grateful. So my dad gets it done. He starts, let me back up. Before he gets it done, it's painted and he's got it home. It's sitting on cinder blocks in our carport along beside my 70 Chevelle. And I think I'm probably 17 or 18. And hard times catches up with my family. They're for about a year or so, there were some lean times. My dad was a carpet installer all his life, so I'm a carpet man's son. I'm proud of that. And those lean times hit. My dad ended up having to sell this car before he actually got it finished. Had the motor built, had all the chrome, had the wheels, tires, had everything. Just didn't have it put together. It was at that stage to be put together. And he ended up selling it to a man in Wilkesboro named Shane Raines. To help with the hard times my family was facing. He was facing the hard times, and that was the decision he made. And it like to killed him to sell it, but he did. Probably a year goes by, and me and one of my best friends, Jeff Martin, Gary's son, we go down to Wilkesboro, North Wilkesboro, to find the 55 and visit Shane Raines, and he allows us to look at it. And he had since put it together, put the motor in it, the seats in it, and all the chrome on it, and I was blown away. And I just knew if I could get my dad to go look at it, he'd buy it back. And I begged him for months to go look at it, and he wouldn't. And I know my dad, and I know him well. Dad don't want to see something that he loves so much after it's gone. He's wanting it really to be on the other side of the country so he don't have to worry about it. That's just how he is. And I finally talked him into going to look at it. And sure enough, when we got down there, it got to his heart, and he ended up buying it back again. So that's the second time he bought it. So then we start really enjoying it. We start going to cruise-ins, car shows. He starts winning all kinds of trophies at these car shows, one right after the other. And this car took on a life of its own. Took it to Pigeon Forge. It won modified class, and I think it was Tri-5 show up there. It might have been the Smoky Mountain something at the time. That was around 98 or 99. We all went. My boys were little. Dad had shirts made for my oldest son that said Pawpaw's 55 and had this 55 on them. And the little boy, my oldest boy, he's probably 6, 7, 8 years old. It's probably 7, 8 years old at that time. He sold them shirts while we was at this car show. And made quite a bit of money. Sold out of them. Tickled my dad to death. And we, dad's never forgot that. So we enjoyed that show. He won Modified and he fired it up. And when he fired it up, there was some people amongst the crowd that heard it fire up. They didn't know what car it was. They just knew they had to get there to see it. And their names were Jim and Sue Butler from Laurinburg, North Carolina. So they heard it fire up and it caught their attention. Sue hustled her husband Jimmy over to the car to find what was making this god-awful racket. And it's loud and it's got a big cam in it and it thumps, it shakes the ground. They meet my dad and they meet the car and they fall in love with it. So they start wanting to buy it from my dad. My dad won't sell it. We get back home and they go home and as time passes, I think they'd exchange numbers and made my dad promise if he ever decided to sell it, let them know first. And they agreed to that. So probably a year or so goes by, my mom gets diagnosed with ovarian cancer. And some of the darkest times of my life fall on me and my family. During that, my dad decides he needs to sell it to help with cancer treatments, to help with bills for mom being out of work. So he calls them up, they decide to buy it, they're grilling a price. I think my dad goes to bed and calls them back the next day and says he couldn't sleep a wink and he just can't sell it. So he backed out on them. And I understand the letdown that must have been for them because they really were falling in love with this car. Jimmy said, "That's okay, Harm. Just call us if you ever decide to sell it again, and we'll be praying for you and your wife, Kathy." And so they thought the story ended there, as did I, because I did not want to see it go. And I was still probably, I was in my 20s, still young and still learning, naive. I thought I'd always end up with this car, that it would be left to me or wheeled to me or, you know, just the naive part of being a young man, wanting to walk in his daddy's footsteps and just dreaming of being like him. And I thought I'd end up with this car. It's funny how life doesn't work that way sometimes. And Mama got worse with cancer. Ended up having to have some experimental treatments in Houston. So sometime later, I don't know if it was 6 months or if it was another year, it may have been close to another year, he decided to sell it for good. And he called them up and to their joy, they got to buy it and they bought it. Dad delivered it to them. And that was the end of that. It broke my dad's heart. My whole family knew it. My brother, my sister, we all knew it. I wish I could have made it different. I wish that I had the money to make it different. But at that time, it's what life threw at you, and it is what it is, the old saying goes. So the Lord brought us through that. My mom went in remission, and we're cancer-free for a while. And I think a few years later, cancer came back, and it spread quickly. They weren't able to do much, and she slowly passed and sadly passed in 2005 on my dad's birthday, January 28th, which is so bittersweet now. It's made me appreciate my family and how I was raised more and more. It's made me cling to my daddy more and more. It's made me know the value of a father more and more. So I made myself a vow and a promise after Mom died that one day I'd buy this car if I could find it. I didn't know where they lived or much about them. I knew when they bought it that I was angry that they bought it. I remember the car leaving for the last time, and I just remember being bitter. There again, that's just so much of what's in a young man's mind when he's still green behind the ears. So after my mom passed, I promised myself I'd find it and buy it one day. I always dreamed if I could win the lottery, I could buy this car back. Not knowing that years later, I would finally get in a position in life to where I could. But before that happened, I started longing for an old car. I went through a divorce the same year that my dad sold his car in 01. So my life began anew. And I started over. And I've always had old cars, Chevelles mainly, Camaros, old 72 Chevrolet trucks, El Caminos, everything but a Tri-5. Almost bought a 55 once. The guy backed out on me at the last minute. And I know why that was. God allowed that to happen. He allowed this to be the first 55 I've ever owned and my last. So amongst the time of dreaming of finding it and wanting to win the lottery and buy it, I began looking for it. My dad never seemed interested in telling me who owned it and what their names were, their contact information, where they lived, how I could reach them. He just kind of blew me off. He said he always had that on a piece of paper somewhere put up. I'd ask him ever so often, maybe once or so a year, and he'd say he'd go find it. He'd dig it out and give it to me. And he never really did. And I knew in the back of my mind that he just didn't want me to find it and try to drag him down there and buy it again, because he was just in a position of life where he was starting over from losing my mom, missing my mom and still mourning. He was just in a position where he probably would never get it again. He did buy a 55 postcard that we found, $6,500 with a six-cylinder. A good driver, it was blue and white. And that was all I was hoping he'd do, was just drive it. But knowing him, he did what he typically would do, and within months he had it tore apart and was painting it and putting interior in it and wheels and tires. And it turned out to be a super nice car. Beautiful car. But it just was not this green 55 hardtop. He remarried to a wonderful woman that God brought in my dad's life. And I know she's added years to my life. Or, I'm sorry, added years to my father's life. And probably added years to mine. She's a blessing. I'm glad she's there for my dad. My dad tried to buy this car back, and I didn't know it. I found out later that he tried to buy it back, but didn't, because he just couldn't afford it, and he settled for buying the one that he repainted. He wasn't ever really satisfied with that car because it wasn't a green one. He ended up selling it after him and Jackie married. And that was it for him in 55s. He swore up and down he was done with old cars. He paid more attention to his yard and his garden. He would turn that ground over every year and plant his corn, his beans. And I'd see this year after year, and I just believed if my dad had something to keep him idle, that it would, you know, add more years, give him more joy in life. And I longed for that, especially since losing my mom. So it come time that I really got serious of finding this car about 12 years ago. I'd take the pictures that I had of them, which was few, and I'd put them on the internet. I'd go look at car show pictures, especially Super Chevy shows in Rockingham. I knew that Dad said they lived near Rockingham, but I never knew if it was Rockingham the town or Rockingham the county. And they're kind of both in each end of the state. One's in the middle and one's further southeast of the state, good ways apart. So I'd scour Super Chevy shows. They keep track of every entry they had, and I'd look through every picture for every year they had it in Rockingham, and never seen this car. Could not ever figure out whatever happened to it, why I couldn't find it, why nobody had ever seen it. So I'd post it on Facebook pages when Facebook started becoming prominent. And this is well into this 12-year search for it. I found that there's all kinds of hot rod pages, 55, 56, 57 pages, Tri-5 pages, Bel Air pages, and I'd post it every chance I got. And amongst these communities where it's just people that love Tri-5s, 55, 56, and 57 Chevrolets, surely they would have seen this car by now. And to my astonishment and my disbelief and my discouragement, no one had ever seen it. The journey to find this car become a story in itself and took on a life of its own and became way more difficult than I ever imagined. I think you've heard me already say that my dad had relayed to me the people lived in Rockingham, but I never knew if it was Rockingham the county or Rockingham the city. And so I would post pictures of the car online, even before Facebook was a thing. I'd do it, you know, post them on MySpace, or I would go search all the Super Chevy shows, seeing if I could see that car at one of the Super Chevy shows, because I knew Super Chevy, they had car shows down in Rockingham, the town. And I knew if that's where they lived, that surely they'd have that 55 at the Super Chevy shows. And Super Chevy are, it's no longer a thing. They don't do no more car shows. I'm not even sure if they're a magazine anymore. They may be out of business, but there's online, there's a catalog of all those car shows, and there's pictures of every entry there, and for years. And so I would go to Rockingham Super Chevy show online and look through every picture just to see if I could see the car, see if I could figure out who the owners were. And to no avail, it just was never there. I never could find it. Nobody ever seen the car. So roughly around 2005, after Mom died, is when I really got to looking for it. And that was 18 years ago. And probably 12 years ago is when I really, really got serious with using online as a tool to try and find it and started looking and searching. Then about 3 years ago, after all that failed, I've got somebody with inside one of the three-letter government agencies that I can't really say, that helped me quite a bit to try and find it. And I was able to locate several 55s that my dad had owned. First one was one of the last one he owned for a short period of time that he sold, because it wasn't this car, and he sold it and remarried. And I wanted to find this one to keep him busy. I've always believed if you keep your hands idle, that you don't let the old man in, as my dad says. And so that was my mission. And so I had this contact that could really help me find it. And he put a lot of time in to look, and he would send me 55s my dad had, and I would look and find the owner and contact him. And went through several, and I had one hit. One come back as a hardtop, which is what this is. The other ones were postcards. And I've always had a VIN number off of a registration card that I've had for years that was my dad's, and I've always held on to it because it had the VIN on it. It's 455 hardtop, and this would have been my easy ticket to find this car. And so I shared all the info off of this registration form with my contact, and they pulled it up, and I found the guy that owned it by name, found him online, found him on Facebook, called him. We got to talking. He started sending me pictures of him, and lo and behold, he had sold the car. So my excitement kind of come down a couple notches, and it went to Florida, but he knew who had it, and it was still in my dad's name. Title was still in my dad's name. And so I'm getting excited again, and I said, man, you got any pictures of it? He sends me pictures, and the pictures he sends me are of a light blue and white hardtop, and my heart immediately fell to the floor. I was devastated. I thought they've painted it from this green to blue and white, and put white wall tires on it, and they've ruined it. It's no longer green. And I thought right then and there my dream was over. There was no way to come back from that. Even if I could buy it back, it'd have to be completely restored, and I know that I couldn't afford that and buy it. And I was devastated. I went and cried, went to the bathroom and cried in secret. I cried the day that I found what I thought was the car, and I cried later that day when I realized that the car, what I thought was the car, was no longer blue, was no longer green, it was blue and white. So a couple of days pass and I'm deeply depressed. I thought my journey ends, and I happen to pull down this registration card and I get to looking at it, and I realize that it's valid through 2003. And it hit me like a ton of bricks that my dad sold this one in 2001, and there's no way I could have a registration card of 2003 with his name on it. And it turns out this was not the correct 55. And my dad had owned another hard top that was turquoise and white for a very short period of time. He sold it fairly quickly, and that's what this car is. They had repainted it light blue and white, and it has exchanged hands several times. So I went from being down in dumps, depressed, thought my journey was over, to being excited again and realized that that was not this car. And so motivated again, contact my contact and let him know. And so we're on the hunt again. And for whatever reason, we just could not find this car. My dad finally gave me the names, and he said, Jim, well, actually, he said Sue Butner. He couldn't really remember Jim's name, but he remembered Sue's, and he thought it was Butner. Dad realized I was serious about finding it, and he finally went and looked for the paper that he had their info on, and he could not find it. He asked me one day several years ago why I wanted the info so bad. I half jokingly and half seriously said, I'm gonna go find that car and I might buy it one day. That was the whole deal, the whole reasoning why I wanted that info. He knew I was serious. But he couldn't find the paper, and he gave me the wrong names, and I started looking for that name, and that was one reason why I couldn't find them. In the middle of that time, I bought a 57 Chevrolet. My stepdaughter wanted to get married, and her fiance wanted an old car. And I had a buddy, Jeremiah Kirby, who had an old 57 that was beautiful. He let me borrow it, and I fell in love with it. As soon as I drove up the road, knew I had to have it, and I bought it. I hadn't had an old car in years since my divorce in 01. And just like that, I was back in the old car game, having a ball. And I knew in the back of my mind that I still wanted to find this car. I still keep posting it and posting it and posting it. Nobody ever seen it. And finally, one day, I posted it on a Rockingham yard sale page. And a lady named Marion that lives in Rockingham, the city, in and around there, messaged me, and she said, I know who owns that car. She said, their name is Jim and Sue Butler, not Butner. She gave me their names and address. And I called them right then and there with tears in my eyes and crying. They were on the other end, answered, and they were astonished that it was me, Harm's son. And Sue hollered at Jim across their house. I could hear it echoing through their home. Jim, it's Harm's son, Chad. And their excitement equaled mine, which surprised me. And before that happened, I'd found several other 55s my dad had owned through the years, including the orange one, and I called the owner of that car. He lives in New Bern, North Carolina, and he was aggravated that I was calling him, asking about it. So I was real worried about calling him. But to my astonishment, they was excited as I was. Turns out they'd been trying to reach my dad for years since my mom passed. And he had tried to reach them. They both had misplaced dad had misplaced their info and couldn't contact them. And all they had was my dad's old phone number and address, 100 Birchdale Drive, Gameau, North Carolina, 828-758-4086. But they couldn't find my dad because he had remarried. He couldn't live in that house no more. It hurt him too much since my mom had passed. So he remarried, and I actually only moved probably 3 or 4 miles from that house in Gainesville. But they just couldn't find him. So they were excited to hear from me. I was excited to hear from them. We both cried tears of joy. I couldn't believe it. They invited us down to go look at it. And go down and look at it, we did. Dad wouldn't go at first. I begged him to go with me and look at it just to see it. He said, no, he didn't want to see it. So I think the day before I was to leave, he said, come pick me up tomorrow, I'll go. And we did. We got down there and met them. And they've got a collection of cars, private collection. And they've got like a museum that's private. It looks a lot like the inside and the outside of a Cracker Barrel, their main building, with nostalgia everywhere, from old signs to old gas pumps to rusty old Ford truck outside in the neatly placed bushes. And it's beautiful. The whole place is beautiful. So they've got a ton of cars. Another 55, Chevelles, Camaros, old trucks, old 40 Fords, nice stuff. Beautiful people, beautiful collection. More importantly, they have big hearts. They opened the garage door, and when my dad seen this car for the first time since 2001, he began to cry. It turned into sobbing. I knew then that I'd never let go of the dream of bringing this car home for him. We looked at it. We looked at the car. I got underneath it, crawled underneath it, looked at it, everything, and it was astonishing to me that it was in the shape that it was in when my dad sold it. They ended up putting less than 500 miles on it. They didn't drive it. They had a guy come a couple times a year to clean it up and buff it and take care of it, and they'd drive it up down the road several times a year just to keep the seals in the motor good and to keep it roadworthy. And it was astonishing that it was in that kind of shape 22 years later. And they allowed us to drive it. Dad said, you drive it, Chad. And I knew that was not going to happen. So I said, you drive it, Dad. It's your car. Even though you don't own it no more, it's still his car. So he's driving and I'm filming. He's grinning from ear to ear as he's shifting gears. Power of how fast and how stout this car is quickly comes back to his mind and mine. As we drive down the road a few miles, turn around and come back. I'll never forget that as long as I live, as well as him crying the first time he'd seen it in 22 years. So we wrapped up our visit. They sent us back with a ton of food, snacks and ribs, and just wonderful people and a wonderful trip. I asked them before we left if they'd ever sell it. I'd love to buy it back for my dad. And I'd asked Dad on the way down. I said, Dad, if they'll ever sell it, do you want to buy it? And he said, no. He said, I'd rather you have it, son. And I probably knew that Dad's in a point in life where he's semi-retired, still delivering parts for Napa. And I knew that would have been a hard thing for him to probably swing. But me, in my mind, I wanted his car as bad as he did, if not worse, for him to enjoy in his late years. I knew that getting it would bring so much joy to him, and that's what I wanted to do ever since he gave me my first Chevelle. So I asked him if they wanted to sell it. They said they'd think about it. And they asked me to go home and pray about it, and they'd pray about it. And I went home and I prayed about it. Been praying about it since 2005. As I think back, I've probably been praying about having a green 55 since I was a kid. And this journey is lifelong for me, and it's just in so many different parts, in so many different facets. And the weekend passes by, and I called them. I told them I prayed about it and I'd love to buy it. 57 that I bought, I knew I'd have to sell to make it work. And they agreed. They gave me a price, and I agreed with it, and which is a good price for today's market on these cars. It was double what my dad sold it for in 2001, and I was happy at the price they gave me. So we were set to buy it. I set to buy it. I called the boy that wanted to buy mine. He was ready to buy it, and everything was going good. A couple days later, when Jim called me, he said his daughter Sharon was attached to this car like I was when I was young. She grew up with this car. She's a little younger than me. After all, they'd had it since 2001, and this was 2022. She really didn't want to sell it, and I know that feeling. I felt it and lived it, and I understood. So, even though it disappointed me and it wasn't what I wanted to hear, I understood it. Jim said, "Don't give up. I know you've looked for this car a long time, and it's God's hand that you found it." And we all know that it was. He said, "Give me 4 or 5 months and call me back. Don't give up." And so, 4 or 5 months go by. I'm afraid to call. I'm scared to call. I know in my mind they're going to tell me no quicker than they would tell my dad. So I conned my dad into calling. He didn't really want to either, but he did. They told my dad they had another 55, and I'd seen it. They had bought one for Sue's father late in his life. And they gave it to him. And it was, that car meant a lot to her too. It was unrestored, and he had since passed away. And they decided they wanted to restore this 55 that they bought for him. And they told my dad that once they restored that one, that they would sell the green one back. So that's all I had to go on. So that was probably around November, October of 2022. And I have not called them at all since that time until a year to the date that we were there in April of 2022 when we seen it for the first time in 21 years. Or 22 years at that time. So I call them, and Sue answers, and I said, "Sue, I just want to see how you're coming along on another 55, if you're getting it restored or where you're at, and maybe see a timeline, because I'm really wanting to buy this car back from Dad." And Sue was pretty short with me, and I knew I probably called her in this, at a busy time. She didn't really have much time to chat like she normally does. She's a wonderful lady. Beautiful lady, warm and just a good heart, and always talks a lot to me. But this day was different. They had something going on. They were busy. They maybe had company. I don't know. But she was short. She said, "If we decide to sell it, we'll call you." Well, I accepted that, and I said, "Okay." And I knew not to press further. So after we hung up, I pretty much was giving up on the notion they were really going to sell it because of how much they loved it and how much they attached. They were attached to it. It was their favorite car in their collection. It was their prize and all their possessions of cars. This was their number one. So I understood and I got it. I didn't tell my dad. Well, no, I did tell my dad. I ended up buying another 57. I did sell my other one to some guys in South Carolina. Did good with it. I made good money on it to go buy another one that I got a great deal in that I spent the whole winter working. Another 57, 150 Black Widow recreation. New interior frame off restoration in 17. Some people let it sit outside and the paint had got real water spotted. Some of the chrome started flaking. Engine wasn't running when I bought it. They'd put the Phytec fuel injection on it. It wasn't right. It wasn't wired up right. And so I bought this from a guy down in Georgia. Bought it at a good price. Took a chance on it and got it home. And cousin Tim Clark come down, we discovered the wires was backwards and the distributor was out, it was all out of time. Fixed it and had it running. And I got lucky on it. I had it buffed, my buddy Tony Bailey buffed it, painted two fenders and a hood for me, and I was good to go. This thing, slick car, the best car I've ever, ever had until this one. And I started getting attached to that 57, and I decided I would never sell it unless they called me with my dad's 55. And I started tearing parts off that car and building it like I wanted, getting it lowered like I wanted, putting the wheels and tires on it I wanted, putting the suspension on it I wanted. And I got it right. And I was tickled to death with that car. Would have been happy with it the rest of my life. And if you ever seen a black and white 57 Witta, they're beautiful. They were made select. The real ones, there were only, there's much debate whether they're a correct number, but there's 12 to 14, maybe 20 made. And they were only made for NASCAR racing and NHRA drag racing. Chevrolet sent them to Atlanta. And they were actually built by a company called Sedco and raced in NASCAR and drag racing. Buck Baker won the 1957 Chevrolet NASCAR championship in a 57 150 black and white. They were legends, and you just can't find them. I think there's two known to exist, with one being in the NASCAR Museum in Charlotte. So I loved mine. It was beautiful and never would part with it. Along the time, I'd give up on getting the green one to an extent. I knew I was just going to keep mine and be happy with it. And I started making a lot of videos of me and my dad going to car shows. And after all, that's why I got a 57 again, partly because I could get him to go to car shows and cruise-ins and get more time with him and make more memories with him and enjoy what time I've got with him. So we did just that. We went to cruises, car shows. My dad loved the car. I'd let him drive it. I'd film. And we went to Wilkesboro, took my grandfather's moonshine, Jasper Shine, which you can get at South Mountain Distilling Company. Shameless plug. We took Casey it and went to Wilkesboro car show, got to go around the racetrack, and I went as hard as that 57 would go. And I videoed a lot of it. We took pictures, and I'd make pictures of me and my dad enjoying this car and make videos of it. And I used videos of where my dad drove this car in April of 22 and intermingle them with videos of the 57 that we were just at the time we were enjoying each other and these old cars. And I sent it to Jim and Sue, and I sent it to their daughter Sharon 4 weeks ago. Didn't hear from them for two or three days. I just sent them the video and told them Merry Christmas, Happy Holidays. Hope y'all are doing well. Just wanted y'all to see how much I enjoy being with my dad and how we're enjoying my 57. But it's still not that green 55, and if you'd ever sell it, I would do what I can to get it and bring it home for him to enjoy. And I meant that and mean that with all my heart, and they knew it. So I didn't hear back from him after I sent the video, and I thought it was odd. They didn't say Merry Christmas. They didn't say Happy Holidays. They didn't say that's a cool video. They didn't say call us, come see us, nothing for two or three days. And I thought, man, that's odd. I must have really made her mad the last time I talked to her back in April. And so I let it go. And two or three days later, they called me on a Monday at work. And I'm busy with customers. And I say I've had three missed calls, and it's from Jim Butler's phone, it's from Jim and Sue Butler's phone, and it's from Sharon, their daughter's phone. She called me from three different numbers. And I thought, man, they must really like that video, or maybe they're mad at me because I shared video of the 55 in their building with their other cars, and because they're private and they don't really want that out there. And so I didn't know what to think. So I called him back, and the first words out of Sue's mouth is, Chad, are you ready to buy this 55? My lips began to tremble. I couldn't get the word yes out of my mouth quick enough. I said, give me a minute. I had to go outside and compose myself. And I said, yes, Sooth, I'd love to buy that 55. I just got to sell mine first, and I got a boy wanting. So all these years of looking for it, all these years of dreaming since I was a kid of owning a green 55 like my daddy, was starting to come together. The last 3 or 4 years of my life, and probably my whole life, but the last 3 or 4 years, I know how much God's blessed me, and I'm unworthy. I'm not worth the way God's blessed me and how good He's been to me and my family and the things He's done for me in my life. But I'll forever be grateful, and I'll forever praise His name and thank Him for it. I've prayed every day, and I literally mean that. I've prayed every day to finally get this car home one day. God knew my intentions, and He knew the pureness of that want and the pureness of my heart that was creating that drive to want to bring it home. He knew I wanted to get it from my dad. And after 12 years of searching, a year and a half of trying to buy it back, it was starting to come true. So I called up a buddy that I'd met and become a buddy and a good friend, Chris Clemens. Chris Clemens owns Alexander Auto LLC. You'll see on my hat. And I told him I'd proudly wear his hat. And I'm going to thank him the rest of my life too, because he quickly come bought my 57. And that allowed me to go buy my dad's 55. Chris sells and buys a lot of cars, so if you're in the mood or want an old car, he's got anything you can think of. He's probably got 20 to 30 cars at any given time, from old Tri-Fis to Chevelles to Impalas, Ford trucks, Chevrolet trucks, you name it, he's got it. And everything he's got, it's right. And I'm thankful to him and his wife, Christy. They're good people and they've been good to me. So I sell mine, I call them back, and a couple days I call Jim and Sue and I say, I've got mine sold, got the money. He wanted cash, $100 bills, and I said, that's no problem, bud, we'll make that happen. So it took us a couple weeks to actually get together. They were out of town and they wanted to spend a little bit more time with it. They wanted to drive it another time or two, wanted their daughter to be around when I bought it. And my nerves was a wreck those past 2 weeks. I had a fear they might back out because they were so attached to it. I had a fear that something might go wrong. And I finally just hit my knees and give it to the Lord like I'd been doing. I'm just letting Him handle it. And He handled it. He sure handled it. I got to pick it up 2 Sundays ago. One of my best friends that I grew up with and I've hot rodded with and chased girls with and grew up in the right way. Richard Saunders, he went with me to get it. We took his clean, pretty 3500 Chevrolet in a pouring rainstorm in an enclosed trailer and went and picked it up. This car hadn't seen rain ever since they've owned it. I don't know if it's ever seen rain. My dad used to park in car washes. He'd find one if it looked like a rainstorm was coming. But since 2001, it's not had no water on it. So I brought it. It quit raining long enough for us to get it loaded. And we brought it home. It was raining storm all the way home. When we got closer to home, the more it rained. So I left it in the trailer that night. I hadn't told many people. It was a big secret. The next night, I got it home and loaded it on the trailer and brought it in here and closed this door and cried like a baby. Opened the door in the garage the next morning to see if it was real, if it was a dream. It's still here. And I just laughed. Laughed like hell. Because it's so unreal that it's sitting here in my garage. And it's got my name on the title. I cannot wait to give it to my dad. The plan is I'm going to give it to him at a family Christmas get-together that we're having a little early on the 22nd, this Friday. And my family thinks the only reason we're having it is because my brother is going out of town and my middle son's going out of town this weekend, that weekend, to see their other members of their family for Christmas, and they won't be here for Christmas. So typically that way every year. So there, I've got my family, along with the help of my brother, conned into thinking it's a family Christmas get-together. I've got Vicky Setzer, who runs and owns 1841 Cafe in Lenore on Main Street. If you've ever heard the Lenore Cruise Inns, go visit her when you're up here at one of them. She's got great food, great place to eat. We've had, Alice has had surprise birthday parties there for me several times, and Alice is my better half. And without her, none of this would be possible. I wouldn't even got to get my first 57 that led me on the path to bring this one home. So I got so many people to thank. But 1841 was where the plan is to do it, and I've hired Justin Eisenhower and Matt Huggins to document it all, two videographers, and we're going to do this thing right, and I'm going to surprise my dad with it. I've only told a select few, no more than I had to tell, people I needed help from, like Jeremiah Kirby, who helped me put drop springs in it. People like my boss, Brandon Eisenhower, and Katie Eisenhower, who allowed me to be off to take care of selling mine and getting this one and doing all the paperwork and stuff that I needed, and for allowing me to get a good deal on my wheels and tires, and to Brandon for mounting my wheels and tires. I want to thank Todd Hawkins for painting these old steely wheels like I envisioned. Hawkins Body Shop. Make sure you check them out as well. I want to thank them. And I am going to grab a piece of paper because at 51, my memory ain't as good as what it used to be. So in no particular order, I want to thank Marion Fink Mizuna. She's the lady that seen my picture on the Rockingham yard sale page and told me where it was at, who owned it. Marion, without you, I don't know if I'd have it. I'd probably still be looking for it. But I was looking for the wrong last name. God does work in mysterious ways, and I appreciate you. Merry Christmas, and God bless you and your family. I'm forever indebted to you, and I'm forever indebted to everybody's name that I'm going to read on this list that's made this possible. Jim and Sue Butler and their daughter Sharon, for letting go of something they love so much to allow my family to love it that same amount again and to bring this thing home. I cannot wait to see the joy in my dad's eyes and the tears that I know is going to come, because when he opens the door, he's going to hear that song I told you about earlier when he gave me my Chevelle when I was 16. Conway Twitty's, "That's My Job." And that's my job, Dad, to help bring you joy and to give back just a small portion of what you gave to me all my life. I am proud to be your son. I am my father's son. Popular song that I love by Stephen Wilson Jr. I just first heard a few days before I was realizing I was going to get this car, and it just come full circle. It's called Father's Son. I am a father's son. I'm a carpet man's son. I'm a tri-fiber son. I'm also a son of God. Love you, Dad. I can't wait to see the joy on your face. The joy in my boys' face. All of them. They were little when this car got gone. Got pictures of them with the car. Pictures of us. My whole family knows what this means. And my brother and sister's going to be tickled as I am. I also want to thank, in no particular order, my cousin Jeremy Saunders. Been a big inspiration, a big help. Appreciate you. Chris Clemens, Alexander Auto LLC, my buddy Lindsey Blair, who's helped me time and time again when I've needed it, buddy. I thank you and I owe you for life, too. One of my best friends, Richard Saunders, man, I'm indebted to you for life. Just like you told me, we're going to be old one day with your dad's 55, my dad's 55, sitting at a car show or cruising somewhere. Reminiscing about this time, about the time we went down to Rain Store and brought the old green machine home. I want to thank Jeremy Kirby, another good friend of mine, for selling me that first 57 I ever owned here a couple years ago, for coming to help me get this thing ready, thrashing in the last few hours before the unveil, and he was instrumental in that. Well, thank my cousin Stephen Triplett for helping me. Helped me come clean it and wipe on it. And everybody that's helped keep this a secret. Todd Hawkins, Hawkins Body Shop, for painting them wheels. I owe you, buddy. You've been good to me and my family, and I know you love my daddy. You painted another 55 for him. It just wasn't this one. But you always done me right. You've always been good, and I appreciate you, Todd. Brandon and Katie Eisenhower, who I work for at Rides of Conover. Wonderful place, man. It goes hand in hand with the things that I enjoy in life, and that's wheels and tires and cars and trucks. Roy Bentley for selling me a 55 tag. I think he's the president of the Apple City Rodders in Taylorsville. Dad's known Roy a long time, and that was fitting that he had a tag that I could put on this thing for Dad, a 55 tag, North Carolina. He also sold me a Wilkes County Moonshiners, capital, Wilkes County tag. It's a topper if you've never seen them, they're rare. It goes on the top of the tag. It says Wilkes County Moonshine Capital of the World. I got that for Christmas for Dad too. He's been wanting one. And Roy Bentley had one, and I appreciate that, buddy. Thank you. Cousin Tim Clark and Lynn for helping me late nights, figuring my other 57s out, teaching me how to work a lot on these old cars, the things that I didn't pick up from my dad growing up, which wasn't a whole lot. I know so much about these cars, but knowing how to work on them electronically and through some of the bugs, Tim, you've been instrumental, buddy, and I appreciate your knowledge and appreciate you being family, man. I love you, and your love for Dad is something I won't forget either. Vicky at 1841 Cafe, thank you for hosting this family party. I cannot wait to get there and unveil this thing. Thank you. Justin Eisenhower at Dark Media, Dark Room Media. Matt Huggins at MattHugginsPhoto.com. My buddy Mike at High Peak Speed and Classics over in Drexel. He's a Dan Chuck dealer. He's got every 55, 56, 57 parts you can think of. New or used, if he can't get it, he'll get it. If he can't get it, you don't need it. There ought to be more people like Mike in this world. Thank you, Mike. I also want to thank Alice, my better half, my rock. She's allowed me to have this crazy dream. And she's bared with this crazy dream. She's bared with me. From a traveling musician gone all the time, to hunting being gone all the time, to finally being home, and messing with these old cars all the time. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for making my dreams possible and helping me be the man that I am. I love you. I love my dad, and I love my boys, and I love my grandchildren and my family, and everybody that's helped me. I love each and every one of y'all, and I'm indebted to all of y'all for the rest of my life. This is a story like I've never heard, and I hope it's touching to you like it is to me. It's special. This car is special. My family's special. My dad's special. I hope one day when God calls me home, that one of my boys has this car, and they remember all these memories and these stories. And I hope somebody tells them stories of me and his Green 55 the way that they've told me and my daddy and his Green 55. I've always wanted to be like my daddy, and I feel like I'm as close as I'm ever going to be right now. One hell of a man, one hell of a father. A grandfather, the best damn carpet laying man you've ever seen. They can't nobody clean up a car like my daddy. Can't nobody build a car like my daddy. I'm proud of him. I'm proud of his love that he shared with me and my family, my boys. And I'm proud to have his last name. I hope you enjoy all this, and I hope you enjoy the reveal that's coming. This has been years in the making. And it's so unreal. Last but not least, I want to thank my Heavenly Father God for saving me, for giving me a promise that I know I'm going to live forever with Him, and I'm going to get to see my mother again and loved ones that have gone on before me. And I know she's looking down right now smiling. And I hope I've made her proud and my dad. I'm lucky and blessed to be born to who I was born to. Thank you all for tolerating this long story. I just wanted to tell it in the right setting and tell it with my heart. I feel like I've done that. Merry Christmas to everybody. Happy holidays. God bless you. I pray for each and every one of you. Y'all pray for me too. God loves you and I do too.
She got it from the Bible, and he passed it on to me like granddaddy's rifle. Raised me up like sweet corn, created a disciple. Yeah, I fought it like hell, he became a rival. Yeah, I tried to be different, tried to go against the grain. Didn't make no difference, I just ended up the same. I've never known better, yeah. 'Cause every bone's tethered. You wanna change my name, gotta drain my blood. Goddamn, I am my father's son. Just to get out of his shadow, and he'd send me a 20 just to get back on the saddle. I put up a good fight, but I didn't win a battle. I guess the tree don't grow very far from the apple. I've never known. To hate being called Junior, now I don't mind any longer. I've never known better. 'Cause every bone's tethered. You wanna change my name, gotta drain my blood. 'Cause everything. Thank you.
Roman style, don't you, son?
Yeah. What do you think?
I'll have you crying, Lord.
Mr. Cool would shake them.
He did it.
Don't do that.
I did.
I just want that.
Oh Lord, he's playing that song. He's playing this much.
I'm gonna get something for you.
We might already go eat because we got to be out there by 6:30.
Yeah, in the club. Pretty good.
I just think had, with what I had to do with wheels and tires, I put two inch drop springs on. Two inch drop springs on. Lower the front. Put 3 inch blocks in the back.
Go ahead.
Our story. We are car people. We were at a car show in Tennessee, and I heard the 55 before I saw it. I told my husband, we're going to find that 55, and we did. I gave Harm my telephone number, and I told him, if you ever sell it, we want it. Time went by, and he called and said, I'm going to sell it. We were in Tennessee, so we were packing up, excited to go and get it. He said, I didn't sleep a wink last night. I can't sell it. So we said, if you ever do, let us know. He did, and January the 2nd, 21 years ago, he brought it to us. Jim drove it down the road, and it started to snow. We had a 40 Ford that Jim was working on. So the 40, we put the 40 in our brick shop and the 55. Then a little later, we had a 40 by 80 building by Arco, and the 55 was the first one to go in it, and it's had the same place for 21 years. It's not been outside in the rain. It's detailed each year. No water's been put on it. I said, we have lots of cars, but the 55 is special. Chad looked for it for 12 years. Just going and looking at our cars was all we ever needed. We collect, we don't sell. That's why he couldn't find it. He had pictures of it and asked, did anyone seen this 55? And a lady from Rockingham told him about us. We are a very close family, like Chad and his family are. He asked if he could come see it, and they did. They made a video of Harm driving it, and when I raised the door, I said, Harm, are you ready to see it? He said, yes. When I raised the door, and he saw it like it was 21 years ago, he cried, and we all did. They wanted to buy it, but we didn't want to sell it. About a year later, Chad called to see if we'd sell. He sent a video, and we cried watching it. I bought my daddy a 55 Chevy and a 50 Ford. I loved him like Chad loves his daddy, and Sharon loves Jim. My daddy's been gone 4.5 years. It's a hurt I have never known before. So with this much love, I think God tests us sometime to see how we feel about stuff, the 55. In life, we never own anything. God loans it to us. So we've had the 55 21 years now with a lot of tears and God allowing us for y'all to have it again. I know how Chad feels giving it to you. I gave Daddy too. We've become close just talking and crying on the phone. God has so blessed us. We have a sign that lights up on our 40 by 80 building that says Treasured Memories. It's filled with lots of cars, original signs, and gas pumps, but more than that, it's filled with love. From our hearts to your family's hearts, Merry Christmas. God bless.
Camaros, I'm just not big on them, but I love that song. Thank you.
All right, Pops. Tell us what you think about the surprise of bringing the 55 home.
Well, it was a surprise. I didn't know nothing about it. We were hanging around that 1841 cafe, waiting on the table, I thought. And they just kept diddle-dallying around. And we was waiting outside, and I heard the car coming. But I didn't know it was this 55. And I thought, well, who in the world's got a green 55 Chevrolet that I don't know about? It still didn't register, because it had different wheels on it. I didn't pick up on that. But when I seen Trey and Tanner, I knowed what it was. And it's hard to say how I felt. It's just like a homecoming. But it was good. I didn't think he'd ever be able to pull it off, because Sue and Jim, they loved this car about as much as I did. And it had to be there. God touched their hearts and worked it out for you, and I'm glad you got it. You think of this as a lot about me, but it's a lot about you enjoying the car long after I'm gone.
About us enjoying it together.
Well, I'll be 76 tomorrow, and I probably got another 10, 15 years.
Well, you go I go through two or three sets of tires by then.
I used to change tires and motors about every month, me and Gary. But
tell me about the old green one, the original, the OG.
Well, I bought that old car after I wrecked that 56 Chevrolet up on Buffalo. And Gary Martin had owned it. I bought that car for $100 from Randy Sane. And I couldn't leave it alone. I had to start changing motors and transmissions, getting it painted. And it was pretty quick. But it was too quick when we was going to the beach. Just a better place and time back in them days.
Tell us about the big red, cruising the big red one. Red Bryant flagging for you that time, and when the old Superbird Dodge come to town, or Plymouth, I don't know what it was.
I think it was early 70, along the 69, I think it's 70. And the boy had, he just got out of the Marines, looked like according to his haircut. And I believe it's a 70 Roadrunner Super B1 that had that, what I call the clothesline back there on the trunk, that big old wing. It was orange, had that black hood thing on it. And he kept us spinning around there in the big, coming out of the big Rebel. I was sitting there, kept watching him. And that old car sounded good. Them cars sound good from a factory. Sound like a race car. So I caught him out there at the big, out there at the recreation center. And we took off out towards the Red Bryant service station. And I handled him pretty good. I pulled him about three car lengths time we got to Red Bryant. Some ribs out there at the road had that old cap of his off. He was flagging for me, waving it. And he didn't mess with me no more. Crazy, I guess, running up and down the road.
Well, I'm glad that you're tickled, because I'm tickled. And I really look forward to us doing a lot with this old thing.
Well, this old car means a lot, because of them grandboys. And your mama passed away. And when I give it up, sell it, because she was so sick, it didn't bother me. And I just forgot all about it. And hoping you would. You kept aggravating me, wanting Sue Jim's number, and I told you I didn't have it, but I had it because I didn't want you fooling with it. Didn't want to ever see it again. But you just kept on and on. You finally got a hold of them. It's a pretty good old car. It ain't a high dollar car. It ain't that $100,000, $200,000 car. But from an old boy from Wilkes County out of Darby to fix up an old car, it looks pretty good. I got some awful good friends that got some nice cars, 55 Chevrolet. I told General Sanders one time, if ain't but two kinds of people, that's people that's got a 55 and others that want one. Me and his daddy, Kerm, Uncle Kerm, used to race a lot. Kerm had that old Chevelle, and I had that old green 55. Kerm, he'd park his and ride with me. He usually had something to drink. We'd prowl around at 12, 1 o'clock in the night. Mama asked me where I'd been. I'd say, well, Uncle Kerm, well, that's all right. She didn't think much about that.
Good times. I've wanted a green 55 since I've seen the pictures in the old family album of the original one. It's just I've never forgot it, and it never let go. So.
Well, I was up at Shady Beach, just a little old place to get you something to buy to eat up there. And I curb hopped there when I was a senior in high school. And then I got an old car. And Richard Ray Dooley pulled in up there in a 69 Chevelle. And it was this color with a black vinyl top. And I got the paint coat off from it. And that's what this car is. It come off of Richard Ray Dooley. Richard Ray's, he's dead and gone too. About all them old boys down on 268 in the river during the Happy Valley, ain't many of them left. I used to wash her old cars out there at the service station on Saturdays. Harvey's and Ross Watson, Bill Evanston, Doug Gilbert, Marvin Fries, Joe Taylor's, Troy's. I'd wash my brother Troy's car. I'd wash 14 or 15 cars a day and hit no dead of winter, about froze to death. Back in, I charge you $3 to wash your car. Press kept a dollar for his water and soap, and I got $2. I'd leave there about 5 o'clock and change clothes and go up Shady Beach and curb off till, I think it's 12 o'clock on Saturday and Friday and Saturday nights, and Sunday night on at 1 o'clock. But I liked it because them old cars, everybody come up there. Pretty good days.
Well, I'm glad you raised me like you did. I love these old cars, and I love having this one, especially. You didn't want to ever get gone again.
Well, I appreciate you getting it. Can't talk most time without crying, but I'm glad you got it. I hope you enjoy it. And your boys.
But, we're going to enjoy
family
it.
Family means, you know, family means everything to me.
Yep. Well, we're going to enjoy it. That's the biggest thing. I got plenty of time.
I told somebody the other day about all I leave, and I leave this world a bad name. But
ain't nothing bad about your name, Dad. Well, here's to the Green 55 and how you raised me, and I love you, and I love Mama to death, and I'm glad it's home, and I look forward to this year going places and tearing the road up and making up for some lost time with this old thing. Mean Joe Green.